your grace keeps chasing me. Your grace is chasing me down, chasing me down. Goodness and mercy following me. Your grace is chasing me down.
Come on, where you are, just lift up your hands as you're about to sing the song. We thank you, Jesus.
Wash me in your blood, in the water of your love. Only you can baptize me. Bring me back to life, Holy Spirit, fire. Only you can baptize me. Say you're enough for me.
Thank you. Jesus for who you are. Thank you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. Thank you that through the blood of Jesus we have been redeemed. We've been forgiven. We have been cleansed, justified, and sanctified. But I want to focus on the second confession of the blood. Through the blood of Jesus, we have been forgiven of our sins. You need to understand, and I was going through this personally in this week of fasting and prayer. You need to understand that unforgiveness within your life will hinder you from the fellowship of God. You need to understand that unforgiveness in your life will hinder you from the breakthrough that God wants to bring in your life. Because you're holding on to the hurt. You're holding on to the pain of the past. Maybe there's a person who has hurt you today, in this week. You need to understand, our pastors tell us that hurt people will hurt people. You cannot be a blessing in someone else's life if you're hurt yourself. And it speaks about it in the book of Matthew. Matthew 5, verse 23 to 24. It says, so if you're presenting a sacrifice at the altar, in the temple, and you suddenly remember that someone has something against you, leave your sacrifice there at the altar. Go and be reconciled to that person. Then come and leave your sacrifice, your offering to God. And one of my pastors was just telling me that a while back, that they were trying to rebuke a demon out of a girl, out of a woman. They were trying to rebuke a demon, but that demon was refusing to leave the body of that woman. And the Holy Spirit told my pastor that, hey, this is not something that you're used to. There's something going on personally within her life. So he stopped, they stopped praying over that girl. And he asked a simple question, do you have unforgiveness within your life? And as soon as she released the hurt and the pain of her past, the demon was gone. It was rebuked. Meaning that you could be in a place where there's unforgiveness within your life. God wants to bring the breakthrough. God wants to bring the blessing and the prosperity. But your unforgiveness is keeping you from that. Through the blood of Jesus, you have been forgiven. So if you have been forgiven of your sins, you need to release the unforgiveness. And we constantly pray the Our Father prayer. We pray the Our Father prayer, but sometimes we don't pray it in understanding. If God forgives us our sins, then we should forgive those who have sinned against us. And this, it could stem from long ago, the traumas of your childhood. Rejection in the womb. The pressure from friends. Maybe you've been rejected from your friends. Maybe you don't even know who you are to that point. Maybe you've been sexually harassed. Maybe stuff has been happening right now, even right now in your life. But you're keeping it a secret. Give it over to God. And it says in Mark 11 verse 25, but when you are praying, like right now, we're praying to God. We're praising and worshiping God. When you are praying, first forgive anyone you are holding a grudge against, so that your Father in heaven will forgive you of your sins. Forgive anyone. And I said earlier on that I was going through it this week, the week of prayer and fasting. I had offense within my life. I was holding a grudge against someone. But I had to apply the word. It's not just about hearing the word, but it's the application of the word. It's the doing of the word. So I had to go to that person. I had to go to that person and release that unoffense and forgive. I received forgiveness, so I had to forgive, and vice versa. That person had to do the same thing. After that, I could fellowship with God. God could be speaking to you day in and day out, but your ears could be blocked because what? Of that unforgiveness. Because what? Of that offense. There's things that are happening in your life on a daily, on a weekly. God won't bring that breakthrough within your life unless you forgive. So with our eyes closed, our hands raised,
You know who you need to forgive. It could even be yourself for sinning. It could even be yourself for going against God's word, God's will, God's purpose over your life. It could be your friends. It could be enemies. It could be family members. It could be your parents. It could be your siblings. It could be that person who has sexually harassed you from your past and you just cannot be set free. It could be that person who has cursed you, who has rejected you. You need to forgive. You need to release the pain because hurt people will hurt people. Maybe you've been cursed a long time ago in the womb that you will be nothing. God has called you to be something in the world. You have a purpose. God has a plan over your life. But you need to forgive. So right now, release. Release that person. Ask God for forgiveness for holding this grudge. You cannot give your life as a sacrifice to the kingdom of God without forgiving. God cannot use you as a tool of mass salvation in the kingdom of God unless you forgive. Release that unforgiveness in your life. Whether you're at a different campus, whether you're at home, whether you're in the auditorium right now, give it over to the Father. That pain, that hurt, give it over to the Father. That rejection, give it over to the Father. You've been wearing a mask because you don't know who you are. Because of the pain of the past, give it to the Father. Bring it to the cross, because through the blood of Jesus, all your sins have been forgiven. So thank you, Heavenly Father, Lord, for who you are. Thank you that you have given your Son as a sacrifice so we could live in freedom in the name of Jesus. That through your blood we've been redeemed. We've been forgiven of all sin. We've been cleansed, Lord God. We've been justified. We've been sanctified, Lord God. You bring restoration right now in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. That through your blood we rebuke all curses. We rebuke all feelings, Lord God, of rejection, Lord God. We rebuke, like, Lord God, a lack of identity in you, Lord Jesus. We rebuke all anxiety, Lord God, all suicidal thoughts, Lord Jesus, because of past traumas, Lord Jesus, because of hurt. Take it away, Lord God. Bring peace within our lives in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord God, for who you are. You are a good God. Thank you, Heavenly Father, Lord. You are working. Your Holy Spirit is working in people's lives right now in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you, Lord God. You need to understand that it is done right now. You need to understand that through your faith, it is done in the name of Jesus. So right now, we need to glorify God. We need to praise God because what? It is done. All the hurt, all the pain has been rebuked in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. It is done in the name of Jesus. 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 Thank you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We glorify your name, Jesus. We praise you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus, that through your blood, Lord God, we have been redeemed, we have been forgiven, cleansed, justified, and sanctified, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God, that it is done in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Heavenly Father, Lord. We serve a good God. We serve a good God. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord Jesus. Vault Nation, let's give one more shout unto God, for he is a good God. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. We glorify you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord Jesus. Vault Nation, if you're in the auditorium or whether or not you're streaming from home or a different campus, you may take your seat and you need to know that we serve a good God. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Hey, Vault Nation.
Hey, wow.
welcome, welcome, welcome. All right, all right. I see that we have some very cool people in the building, right? Because we have, this is the best place to be on a Friday night.
The best. Where else would you be on a Friday? Can I get an amen?
All right. So please make sure that you have this very important sticker on you to make sure that you have been registered. If you haven't, one of the ushers that are wearing a team tag will help you on the side. And so, Shanice, what are the announcements for this week?
Right, so we just had a powerful week, and if you know, you know, right? We come from prayer and fasting. Who was with us during this week?
Oh, yeah.
We see you there online as well.
All right.
We had such a powerful week that has passed, and I know so much transition has taken place in my life, right? And I can only imagine the amount of testimonies we have in this room, yet alone online, guys. We had such a powerful week. We also have prayer, right?
Yes.
Tell us a little bit more about that. That's
all
coming
right.
up.
Right. So because women always have a little bit of, you know, in them, every Tuesdays and Thursdays, 5 a.m. with Pastor Shanae, there is prayer. So please make sure that you get connected. Go to your cell leader, go to the person who invited you to make sure that you are connected. And is there any men in the room?
Can I get a woo?
Ivo, can you please
men,
get,
can
a
we get a woo? We
all
hear you right. online as well.
Every Wednesday is 5 a.m. with Pastor Bert, right? You guys also have prayer. Please make sure that you get connected. So there is something exciting happening just for the ladies.
Guys, where are
in
the
September.
Queens? Ladies, can I get an amen? Hi, Bo.
Is there no girls in the crowd?
No, I think they want to know what's coming up.
All right.
How many weeks do we have left, sis?
Three weeks
until what?
Women's Conference.
Wow. Woo!
Right. I am so excited,
guys. Yes. So stoked. Please get registered.
Yes.
Get your aunties registered. Your sisters registered. And gents, you are not let off easily.
Not excuse, guys. Get your crush registered. Get your sister registered.
Right?
Get your mother registered. Everybody must be there.
Yes. Amen. And without further ado, we're going to give it up. It's time to give. Are you ready to give? Are you ready to give? All right. Let's give unto the Lord today. Enjoy the service. Bye.
Amen. It's getting warmer. Praise God. I still need a jacket though. It's kind of cold today, but I came without one. I'm going to have to channel my inner burki tonight. Hallelujah. How are you guys doing? You well? Good. Good to have you here. And we know that holidays are over. School is back and private schools or IEB schools are on holiday and they just got their reports. Yeah. I was on the phone with someone today. I was like, how did you do? He said, no, I failed. I was like, eh. And he's like, no, I failed myself. I was like, oh, this guy, be specific when you speak to me. But we're going to give unto the Lord today. And it's so important to give. And let me teach you something, that giving money is the lowest form of giving. So if you're somebody that says, I want to be a disciple maker, I want to impact people's lives, I want to lay down my life for people. If you don't first give your money, I can tell you now, you'll never give of your life. Never. Because you guys all see the people that beg on the sides of the roads, right? Is it easier to do? Is it easier to give them 5 rand or to help them become a business person? 5 rand, right? It's difficult. Take them to your house, let them have a shower, a bath, go buy them clothes, buy them food. Because that's what really matters. Who would agree? Right? It's easy. But that's how people are. They think, no, I'm serving God. But if you're someone that doesn't give, then you're not really serving the Lord. Because to serve the Lord, you need to lay down your life. Jesus says in the book of Luke, he says, any person that doesn't deny themselves, take up their cross and follow me, isn't fit to serve the kingdom of God. That's what it costs to serve God. Who wants to serve God? Hallelujah. Amen. So I want to share a story with you in the book of 1 Kings chapter 7. There's a widow. God tells the prophet Eli, he says, go to this place. I forgot the name of the town. And he said, there I'm going to have a widow that's going to feed you. And he went there and he saw the widow and he said, please, can you give me some water? She said yes as she started getting water for him. He said, may you also give me food. She said, I swear to you on the Bible. I don't know what you guys say nowadays when you swear to people, or I just know the Kardashians say Bible. Don't ask me how I know that. My wife watches the Kardashians. Not anymore. Right? Whatever you guys say. She said, I promise you that I only have some flour. I was going to make a loaf of bread, and then me and my son were going to eat it and then die. That's what she said to him. But he said, you know what? Go make the bread. Give me the bread. Give it to me. Put it in my hands. And then you can eat. And then she had faith. Everybody say she had faith. She went to her house, she collected the ingredients, she told her son, come, we're going to make it for the prophet. And then she put it in her hands, and what happened was he blessed it and he blessed her. And then after she received, she then had more than she needed. Then she could live longer with her son and she could make a living. Why? Because when you put things in God's hands, doesn't matter how much it is, he can do more than we can do with it. So it's not about it being 2 rand, 3 rand, 4 rand, 5 rand. When I was a teenager, I also only gave God 5 rand. When I went to school every Friday, my mom would give me 5 rand to go to the tuck shop. Now I know there's inflation now, so 5 rand's only gonna get you like a lollipop or something. I could buy a hot dog with 5 rand, believe it. Yes, I'm that old, goodness gracious, right? But when you give it to God, and you have faith and you obey his word, even when it doesn't look good, even when your little bank savings card, the orange EBSA card, if you have that one, that's the one I had, or whatever, or your mother gives you 1 rand or 2 rand, be faithful, because God can do so much more with what you have than you can, because we serve a great God. Amen. Amen. Won't you close your eyes and pray with me? Father, we thank you that in this time, we can have faith, and when we put our finances in you, when we trust you, God, you can do more for us than we could think, more for us than we could imagine, and we put our faith in you tonight, God. You are Jehovah Jireh, our provider, and we know, God, that as we sow into your kingdom, as we sow into the church, you will bless us, not only financially, God, but you will take care of us in every aspect of our lives. In your name we pray, amen and amen.
Are you ready to give? Log on to the my3c.tv website for your cashless donations. Made safe, made simple, made smart. Choose your donation option, enter your amount, and press pay now. Choose from one of our easy and convenient payment methods, and you're good to go. You can give via credit or check card, instant EFT, or QR code apps. My3c.tv, cashless donations. Made safe, made simple, made smart. Fix your eyes on the screen for the QR code.
Us for our annual It's a Girl Thing conference on the 8th to the 9th of September 2023, hosted by Pastor Shanae Pretorius at the Moraletta Church in Tshwane, with guest speakers Pastor Geraldine Bolano, Pastor Johanna Cassianos, Pastor John Jenkins, First Lady Trina Jenkins, and joining us live, Grammy Award winning artist Cece Winant. Visit www.my3c.tv and get registered today.
Thobelang Mahlasedi, we are here today in the Twickenham Mines. And let me tell you, we're excited to go out with awesome vouchers that the Masha Sedi Foundation has contributed towards making a difference in this awesome day. So great to be out here. We are with the team. We are going through and visiting houses and visiting families around the mines as they have been settled here. And we are just bringing them joy, bringing them hope, and just loving them. Thank you to every person who has contributed to the Masha Sedi Foundation. We are here in Limpopo because of you. We are here touching lives in these awesome, awesome mine working families. We are here because of your contribution and your donations to the Masha Sedi Foundation. The future really beams with hope.
There you have it. Amen. Matla Sedi is doing the most. Matla Sedi is doing the most. Awesome. We're going to get right into it. But before we do so, let us greet those who are joining us at the different campuses. Let us welcome Nigel, Duduza, Alberton. So good to have you guys join in and being a part of this. And a hand for those in Centurion. There you have it. There you have it. Okay, somebody lost their card. I don't know what happened during tithes and offering, but it says Mr. KG Kota. Anybody? Anybody? Where they at? Fetch your card, please. Fetch your card, okay? I don't mind tapping. Any season. Okay. There you have it. Okay, we're gonna get right into it. And then also a reminder, we have tutoring lessons, okay? Should any of you struggle with academics, what a story, right? Or you have a challenging experience with certain modules, oh, they call it subjects in high school, ne? Subjects, if you're struggling with certain subjects or whatever it might be, we have tutoring. So you guys know my husband, right? Tristan, wherever he is, you can just speak to him. Okay, you can speak to him about getting connected to those extra lessons and being a part of it. So they are tutoring, they're helping with maths, they're helping with science, and so on and so forth. So if you do need extra lessons, feel free to speak to him as well, okay? Because we are here to empower you guys, right? You're not just here to get entertained. We're here to empower you and to make sure that really even your future is bright and that you are getting the education that you need. Awesome. We're going to get into it, but before we do, I want to do a quick, I don't have a lot of time, but we're going to do a quick icebreaker. Who likes to play games? Okay, I need two volunteers that can come up on stage and play a game with me. First come, first serve. Run to the stage if you want to play a game with me. Let's give them a hand. Do you guys already know where this is going? Do you guys know this game? No ways, you don't know this game. I'm disappointed. I thought I'm preaching to South Africans, but anyways, Okay, y'all are watching TikTok too much. Okay, you gotta play some games. Okay, so with this game, right, they usually throw this ball at you and you gotta duck. Okay, you gotta duck and you gotta move. Okay, this is not supposed to touch you. If it touches you, pretty much game over. Now it's your turn to have to throw the ball. Okay, right. But I want you to do something first before I get into this. I want them to not duck. Okay? Right? You guys volunteered yourself for the worst thing possible because you just volunteered to be hit. Okay? Right? I want them to not duck. Okay? And I'm going to make an illustration. Okay? Are you guys ready for this? Are you ready? Are you ready? You are sort of kind of ducking, Tanisha. Are you ready? Don't duck. Don't duck. Don't flinch. Don't flinch. Well done. You didn't flinch at all, okay? Now I want you guys to do your best to duck, okay? You gotta do all crazy moves. I don't know anybody who's ever really played it. You've seen how crazy they go with this, right? They go ha, and they go pa, and they go pa, okay? So you guys gotta do your best to duck, okay? Right? Are you guys ready for it? Okay. Now this, I want you guys to see it as a representation, okay? A representation of fiery darts that the enemy keep throwing at you. And you have to do your best to duck, okay? Let's go. Caesar! Girl, you're not ducking. He even went off stage. He even went on stage. Let's try again. Okay. Guys. Guys. This audience is not the one. These orcs are not the ones. Okay, let's try that again. Let's try that again. Okay. Guys, throw it back. Let's throw it back. One more time. One more time. Okay. Duck. With all your might. Okay, otherwise we're doing this all night. Guys, we're not gonna do this all night. I have to get somebody to duck this fiery dart. You gotta duck it. You gotta duck it, okay? Don't wait for me. You gotta go crazy, right? Get ready, run off stage if you have to. Okay. Okay. One, two, one, two. Okay, we're gonna do this all night, guys. Let's give them a hand. Let's give him a hand. You can keep that. There's something great in that ball. Enjoy. But okay, they didn't really do what I wanted them to do, okay? The whole point is to duck from the fiery darts that come your way. And we're gonna be talking a little bit today about, you know, dealing with troubles and dealing with situations that, you know, we find ourselves in a place where all of these trials, all of these troubles, they lead us to a place where we are really discouraged, even in our faith. We are really in a place of, you know, being demotivated. And God says opposite. God says opposite to how we deal and how we handle things like, you know what, the enemy throwing things our way that lead to oppression, the enemy throwing things our way that lead to sadness, that lead to being discouraged, that leads to being demotivated. It leads to being in a place of absolute faithlessness, to be realistic. And so we're going to be looking at the book of Acts chapter 16 and verse 23 to 24. And I shared this morning when I went to a high school. Who's from Amberfield, by the way? Amberfield in the building. Hi, guys. So you guys get to hear it twice. So Acts chapter 16, verse 23 to 34, it reads here, "And when they had laid many stripes on them, them being Paul and Silas." So these apostles were doing what was right. They were preaching the gospel. They went out and they ministered and they did that which God told them to do. They were obedient. They were obedient and they did not, you know, hold back. They did not hold back. They did not let society, they did not let anybody dictate whether or not they're going to be in a state of following the purpose of God. And they were doing what was right. But now they find themselves in a little bit of a situation here where they are beaten, right? They are beaten, they are struck down, and they end up in a prisoner, right? And there was a commanding jailer there that was responsible to secure them and make sure that they went nowhere. Look at their response towards being untreated fairly, towards being untreated with prejudice. Because how would you feel if you go to prison for doing something right? How would that feel? That would feel unfair, right? Imagine if all of a sudden police just gang up on us in this building and they say, we are arresting you because you are Christians. Jay, how would you feel? It's like, what? What? Where's the wrong in that? But they got arrested, and even on top of that, they were beaten down, they were battered, they were bruised, right? They found themselves in the worst possible situation, punished for doing what was right. It continues to say here in verse 25, but at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and their prisoners were listening to them. What an interesting response to dealing with situations, to dealing with this problem, to dealing with this heavy, you know, trial that they find themselves in, being imprisoned. And I want to make it relatable to you, to your situation. As soon as something goes wrong in your life, as soon as, I don't know, somebody embarrasses you at school, or your parents get in a fight with you, or, I don't know, somebody breaks up with you, or, I don't know, like, as soon as just something goes wrong, you are not doing well in school, you know, mentally, things are just going bad to worse, from bad to worse, and all of these things. On top of that, is your response, I'm gonna praise God? Is your response, I have joy in the Lord, I'm gonna sing hymns, I'm gonna praise Him, I'm gonna pray? Or is your response, I can't do this. God, where are you? Why have you forsaken me? Why don't you care? See, many of us, I'm missing the whole point of why we have Jesus in our lives. We're playing this dangerous game of religion where we think Jesus is just here to decorate our lives so that we can look good on the outside. But He's saying, even in the deepest of your trials, just praise, just sing, just have joy, because that's everything you could possibly need. Consider it joy when troubles come your way, the Bible says. Consider it joy, which means that it does not matter whether you are going through the toughest season or even the lightest season. This needs to be your attitude in life. I will praise God. I will praise God. I will praise God. And not only that, I will pray. I will pray. I will pray. We have to pray. One thing I want you guys to get from this message today is to look at the practicality of how to deal with your situation or how to deal with your troubles. Because many of us can be so filled with so many questions. Oh, I'm going through the most. How do I go about doing this? And then we teach you here at the vault, but still we have to deal with you in our PIDs because you just never apply the word. When you go through problems, are you praising God? Are you praying and asking God to give you wisdom so that you can go through these problems with Him? And I love how it continues to say, even beyond the praying and the singing, God brings breakthrough. And what He does is there's an earthquake, right? There's an earthquake, and then the jail cells doors, they go open. The shackles that were binding them got loose. And pretty much you could say there was a bit of a breakthrough over there. They had an opportunity to escape this horrible condition of them being punished for doing what was good. But that is not what they did. They did not escape because there was purpose behind their trial. And purpose triumphed their pain. Purpose triumphed what they were going through. What happened is now, as this earthquake is happening, and we read in the beginning of the verses there, that the jailer had a responsibility to make sure that Paul and Silas were secured in the prison and that they don't go anywhere, because they were like dangerous people in their day for spreading the gospel. And there, this jailer that is responsible for them sees what has happened, sees that now the doors of the prison are open, sees that their shackles have gone loose. And what does he do? He attempts to commit suicide. He attempts to commit suicide because he already knows if these people go free, that's it. His life done. The government will not have it. The people that arrested these guys will not have it. He's going to be his life for their life, pretty much. That was the situation. That was the situation. And many of us, we can be such short-sighted Christians that we think, okay, because we're praising the Lord and everything was great, oh my God, he even opened up the doors, you know, and the shackles are free. Let me get out of here. Because many of you, you receive the miracle of God working in and through your life, and immediately when that miracle comes your way, you go back to the world. You go back to the world. You go back to pursuing the old ways. You go back to the world, you think, okay, God just saved me for the sake of me and I'm lucky. Yay! God saves you for purpose. He saves you for purpose. Because what happened now, as this guy was about to commit suicide, Paul and Silas, they shouted aloud, no, don't harm yourself. Don't harm yourself. We are still here. We're not going anywhere. We understand this responsibility. See, they had purpose. And you know what happened with this jailer when he saw the response of Paul and Silas to the situation that they were having? This jailer was so amazed that he even said, lead me to your God. Lead me to your Jesus. Lead me to your Jesus. And because Paul and Silas stayed, that man got saved. And not only him, his family got saved. His family got baptized, the scripture said. Imagine that. It could have looked like the answer is God gave an earthquake and we must be set free. But no, the purpose of God was that they go to that prison and set that jailer's life free from the shackles of what he was going through. See, your pain means nothing compared to the purpose behind what God wants you to go through. You go through trials, you go through troubles, you go through tribulations. Not that you can self-pity and, you know, feel bad and feel useless and feel like, you know, you are not worthy or you can't do it or whatever it might be. God doesn't make you go through the toughest of times for no reason. He wants you to go through it because there is purpose behind it. He wants you to go through the storm because there is purpose behind it. He wants you to go through the fire because there is purpose behind it. He doesn't just want you to go through it for the sake of going through it. He will get you through to the other side. I can mention so many scriptures, so many stories, so many characters in the Bible that went through flipping hell and fire, but they came out on the other side way better than the mess that they found themselves in. Because that is the type of God that we serve. That is the type of God that we serve. Some of you, you are crying to God, oh, I'm going through the most. Please just take me out. I can't deal with this anymore. How long am I going to be depressed? What's going on? I just can't control myself. This is horrible. Like, childish faith, faithlessness, this is the standard of Jesus' faith. Trust me, I know what I'm doing. Trust me, I know what I'm doing. What you are going through is not for no reason. There is purpose, because there will be a testimony that will come from this. And your testimony is going to save the next person. Your testimony is going to save the next person. Your testimony is going to save the next person.
just like that jailer who was close to committing suicide. See, our job as children of God is to take the situations that are coming our way and really bring it before God and say, God, we're praising you. We are praying through this situation so you can help us, because the next person that doesn't know Jesus is ready to commit suicide, is ready to die, is ready to take themselves out of this world. But I know that I have a living Savior that has helped me with my issue, that has helped me with my troubles, and my testimony can save the next person. Your testimony can save the next person. See, we're not here at church for the sake of playing church. God has a purpose for you beyond these doors. Your story, your testimony, what you go through, what you overcome, God wants to use you to tell the next person who is struggling, who does not have a God. He wants to use your story to lead them closer and closer and closer and closer to Him, because this is our mandate. The more we will share our story, the more we will share our testimony, the more many will come to God, the more many will come to have revelation of Christ, the more many will be born again, the more many will have new life, the more many will have purpose in Christ. But thing is, Christians, we need to wake up and understand that especially in this generation, it's enough talk. We need to start doing. It's enough talk. It's enough hearing the word, but we're doing nothing about it. It's enough saying, this is how you deal with troubles, and God says, this is how you must do it, but we don't do it. We never see the breakthrough. And I love how, even with this jailer, as he was about to commit suicide, there he found himself saved. And mind you, Jesus didn't come from heaven and try to save this jailer, no. God used the situation with Paul and Silas and their faith and where they were at to bring this man to salvation. And as he got saved, he went and told the good news to his family, and the family got baptized. And now this jailer even considered himself and was given purpose, right? He was given purpose. And he goes back even to Paul and Silas. It says that he cleaned up their wounds. He cleaned up their wounds. Now, Paul and Silas found themselves in this horrible situation, but at the same time, it is the most rewarding situation, because here they stand before a redeemed man, and through their testimony of dealing with that situation, this redeemed man made an influence, and even the prisoners that were all around them saw and testified and witnessed what was happening, and their lives were changed and transformed. And God is calling us to stop playing games, stop playing church, and begin to take seriously His word. Begin to take seriously His word, because we serve a living God. Amen. He's not dead. He's living. He's still working. That was not Paul and Silas' story 2,000 years ago. That is my story today. Someone preached to me, and I'm preaching to you here today. That is not their story back then. God is still moving. All powerful. His word is true, and we need to have faith in that. We must not forget, just how faithful He has been in our lives. Some of us have, you guys, you know, you've really encountered some horrible times and seasons in life, but look at you, you're still standing. Because God has purpose for you. God has purpose for you. And I want us to just close our eyes and bow our heads, say where you are. And I want this to become a moment between you and God. I want this to be a moment where you will evaluate where you are with God. You might be hearing me today, seeing the scriptures, thinking to yourself, oh, I have fallen short. I really don't understand. I don't know how to deal even with the troubles of my life. I don't know how to navigate my faith. Some of you here today, you know for sure your relationship with God is not where it's supposed to be, and that's why you're dealing with problems all by yourself, trying to sort it out all by yourself. But today I'm here to remind you that there is a living God. There is a Savior. There is a God who loves you and who wishes to see you better on the other side. And I want to give you guys an opportunity. If you know you don't have a relationship with Jesus, I want to pray a prayer of faith where you can receive Him into your life today, so that even what I'm saying today will be a part of who you are. So right there where you are, forget about the person next to you. Focus in and lean in to the voice of God. He's speaking to you. And you know you've been far. You know you're distant. You know you're not supposed to be where you are because you don't have him. So on a count of three, if you want to receive Jesus in your life, I'm going to pray with you. And I want you to just raise your hand so that I can pray. One, two, three. Raise your hand if you want to receive Jesus. Raise your hand if you want to receive Jesus in this place. Secondly, you might be a person. You can put your hands down. You might be a person that at some point in time you did understand God, but you know you're fallen. You know you're fallen because you are in the religious way of doing things. You are constantly chasing religion, and you have become so familiar with the ways of God that there's no passion and fire anymore. There's no passion and fire anymore. He's not your Lord and Savior. You know there are other things that have replaced him in your life. I want to give you a chance to recommit, to put him back as number one in your heart. So right there where you are, won't you just raise your hand on the count of three? If you want to receive Jesus again, one, two, three, raise those hands. Raise those hands. I see them. I see you. I see you. I see you. I see you. You can put it down. I want you guys to do one more thing. If you raise your hand, let's all stand. If you raise your hand, won't you quickly come out here in the front so I can pray with you? Come here in the front so I can pray with you to receive Christ. Don't be ashamed. If you raise your hand, you can come out to the front. Have faith, be bold, come to the front. Don't let anything get in the way. Have faith and come to the front. Come on, let's give them a hand. There's still more coming. Come to the front, come to the front, come to the front. Don't be ashamed, come to the front. Come to the front, don't be ashamed. Jesus is here today, Jesus is here today. Jesus is here today and he sees you. Come on, check with your neighbor. Ask your neighbor, do you gotta be in the front? You wanna be in the front, right? Amen. Amen. Won't you just close your eyes here with me and just repeat after me? Say, Heavenly Father, thank you that you see me even at the point of my need. Lord, forgive me for all my sins. Forgive me, Lord. We have run away. We have rebelled against you. Lord, I pray, come into my life. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. Thank you, Lord, that nothing and no one can snatch me away from your hand. Thank you that your love dwells in me and I can love others. I thank you, Lord, that you give me purpose. You give me meaning, and that I'm now your child. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah. For every single one of you here in the front, we're so proud of you for this decision that you've made to say, I am going to follow Jesus. I am going to follow Jesus. It's the best thing you could ever do for yourself. I was once here in the front and my life was truly transformed. And I believe that God will continue to do that in your life. But now that you've been saved, there is purpose. There is purpose. We want to connect with you. We want to get to know you a little bit better, right? So right there where you are, there are guys on the sides waving. There are guys on the sides waving. Those who are on this side, there are those two guys over there. And those who are on this side, there are those guys over there. Won't you just quickly follow them? They want to contact you, get in contact with you so we can connect you to everything that we do. And then straight after that, you guys can... Is there a closing song? Yes, okay. But you can go, you can go, you can go. Okay, let's give them a hand. 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 Hallelujah. God is faithful. People are getting saved. Would you look at that? This is why we are here at the vault. This is why we're here at the vault. Amen. 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 Awesome. We we're going to close the service now, but let me just quickly pray with you guys. Pray a blessing over you. Heavenly Father, Lord of God, thank you that for every single individual here, you see them at the point of need, and every season, every trouble, Lord of God, every situation, thank you that it's being covered. Thank you, Lord of God, that you've already made a way for us to go through what you have destined. Thank you, Lord of God, that in every time, in every season, Lord, we will understand that there is purpose behind pain, Lord, that there is purpose and that you are taking us forward and moving us forward. Lord, reveal to us and help us understand that we can consider it joy when troubles come our way. I pray that, Lord, you will continue to bless every individual, Lord, with revelation knowledge on how to deal with their situation or how to deal with their troubles. Give them wisdom in their going in and going out, and provide for them at the point of need. And the church said, amen. Amen and amen and amen and amen. Awesome, everybody. God is faithful. God is good. Make sure that even in the week that you are dealing with everything in God's way. Amen. Amen. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Generation belongs to you.